Hello there, students. Here we are again. This is Thinking Out Loud Series 3. And today we are going to talk about the pause. You are right? It's to pause and stop and think for a bit. And we are seeing here that we all need a break. And it's compulsory. Okay? Here we go. When do we pause? We pause when we feel disappointed. We pause when we feel doubtful. We pause when we feel angry. We pause when we feel tired. And we pause when we feel sad. So we have a quick run through of the feelings that are listed down here. They are all pretty bad. They are all pretty down and pretty negative. Alright? So in other words, these are the feelings that will make us start spiraling down in our head. And then it brings down our heart. And it makes us feel that it's hopeless and that we are helpless. So in order for that not to happen, we got to figure out what to do. But before that, let's take a look at why is this pause important in our lives. There are two main reasons. One, our attention drifts after a while. This was a research conducted by Microsoft back in 2015. Bear in mind that today is 2021, so it's a good 5 to 6 years ago. So obviously it was a market survey. They did it to gauge the attention span of the consumers using the products. And surprisingly, or rather shockingly, it was found that the average attention span of a human mind back in year 2000 was 12 seconds. 12 seconds. And that is like 2000, right? Year 2000. And in 2015, 15 years down the road, they did it again, the survey, found that it has reduced to 8 seconds. Okay, just let's pause a little bit, around there, and think. On the right side of the diagram, you can see here, a goldfish, which we always think that is not too brilliant, can be kept in the fishbowl, or tiny fishbowl, and the goldfish will be happy swimming around there all year round, if it's that long life, because it doesn't remember that it was there previously. And it has an attention span of 9 seconds. So in comparison, we seem to be lagging behind by a second back in 2015. So that shows how quickly we drift in our attention. And the second reason why it pause is that our brain needs time to process new information and to make connections with the old ones. So this is about if we do not pause and keep getting the information coming in, the neurotransmitters, which are the ones that are sending and receiving, are out of sync. They cannot be working together. So a lot of the information are actually being bounced back or just lost along the transmission line. In other words, this information overloading coming through, overwhelming us these days, need to be handled by taking pauses. Okay? Now, what do we do? What do we do to handle these pause sessions we're talking about? Number one, we prioritize. The first step, we learn to prioritize. So when we talk about prioritizing, now we start to have a priority list. We list down the things that we need to do, 1, 2, 3, in accordance to the importance of it, the urgency of it. By doing that, we will be unloading this unnecessary stress from our head onto the paper. Once it's written down, we know that it is already noted, and we'll start taking action and start thinking through about what to do. But if we keep it in our head, it's a kind of burden, and we keep nagging us about it. Remember the Zeigarnik effect that we talked about in the Thinking Out Loud series 1? So that is what we're talking about. Alright? And by putting it down on the priority list, it doesn't help us to find questions or identify questions which we have not thought about before this in terms of things that we need to do. Alright? And the second step is that we'll start to review our priority list. When we start to review, what we're doing is that we're trying to fill in the gaps. Okay, and this will help us to clarify the confusions and the uncertainties that we have about the job at hand. And by doing this, we are actually revisiting what we need to do, what we haven't done, and preparing for the next step. And this will help us, guide us to avoid overlooking important things, tiny things that we thought they are not important, that's why we overlook them, but they will prove to be the little screw, little nut that has not been tightened and caused the probably a failure or delay of a completion of a certain task or a certain job. Okay? And the third step, we're talking about retrieving. Retrieve means what? We are talking about recalling, reflecting on, and relating our prior knowledge, our prior experience, the things that we already knew, kept in the back of our head, into the context, into the current problem. Alright? When we do that, what we are doing is that we are trying to tap on to the wealth of knowledge, wealth of experience that we have within us, and put them into the situation that is that we are facing now. And this will involve a lot of critical thinking. And by conducting this exercise of pulling out information, knowledge, experience from before, and trying to suit it, to adapt it into the current situation, current problem, this critical thinking process will actually help to move the information from the short-term memory to the long-term memory storage in our head. Meaning what? Meaning that you put it into your database and you'll be getting more and more easily retrievable for the next situation when you need that information or that knowledge. Okay? And we move on to the last step, last but not least, then we prepare three answers or three solutions. Just three will do. You do not have to prepare 30 or 13, there are too many. When there are too many, again, we get befuddled, we get confused, we get nervous, we get stressed out. So three will do. When we list down the top three, right, solutions that we have, we list down as well the pros and the cons, the strengths and the weaknesses of each one of the solution. With that, we start to rearrange them according to a priority line as well. So the best solution, the second best, and the third best. And from there, we review which is the one that is the best. And you can start looking at your pros and cons for each of the solution or each of the option again. There may be some that can be moved about to suit the situation. Alright? And from there, what do? You're right. We are going to start out our action plan. And remember what you said about plan? A plan is a timeline with the activities inserted or slotted in. And what are these activities? We talk about having progress goals, which are the milestones, the little achievements, and the ultimate goal. So you need all these in place before we can start to execute a plan that is workable and feasible and that can be reviewed and improved along the way. Alright? And remember, when we pause and we go through the four steps, that is to prioritize and we review, retrieve, and we start to list down the top three solutions, and then we pray. Once we have made up our mind, we pray that we are given the strength, we are given the clarity of mind to pick or to make the best option, to make the best selection based on our best judgment and based on circumstances that we are facing. Right? Then we proceed with our plan. So with that, my dear students, remember, learn to unleash the 90% potential, the latent potential that is inside you. It's not in the wardrobe, it's not in your neighbor's kitchen, it's not under the table, it's there, inside you. Learn to unleash it, learn to be confident. Alright, so that's all for today. Thank you very much. Bye-bye, stay safe.